Now we're going to see the cerebrates versus the corticates posterior. We will begin reviewing the vestibulospinal tract and rubrospinal tract. So rubrospinal tract is mainly influenced by the neurotendinous anterior muscular spindles, and the vestibulospinal tract is influenced by the vestibular system when we turn the head due to linear or angular acceleration, and the neuromuscular and neurotendinous spindles. So these spindles, the neuromuscular and neurotendinous spindles, are sensed by this dendrite, which bodies lie on the dorsal root ganglia. Here now the axon will synapse on the posterior funiculus, could be the lateral, so sorry, the posterior funiculus at the gracilis or cuneatus nucleus, depending on which level we are coming. If we are at the 1L3, then this neuron will synapse on gracilis in the dorsal nucleus of Clark. If we are below L3, the axon will ascend through gracilis, and at T1L3 will synapse. Then the axon will turn lateral and ascend as the dorsal spinocerebellar tract. If we are at above T1 level, then the neuron will synapse on the accessory nucleus of cuneatus and ascend as the cuneocerebellar tract. This will synapse on the cerebellar cortex, and this enter as Mossi fibers. Now the dorsal spinocerebellar tract is going to end at the fastigial nucleus, and the cuneocerebellar tract in the emboliform and globose nuclei in the parabermal hemisphere. Remember that Mossi fibers go to granular cells release glutamate to Purkinje cells, and Purkinje cells release GABA to the fascial nucleus or the emboliform and globose nucleus. Then the axons of the from the fascial nucleus descend through the inferior cerebellar peduncles, here also the inferior cerebellar peduncles, and end up in the vestibular and reticular formation, but we care about the vestibular vestibular nucleus. Also, now the tracts descending from the emboliform and globose nuclei, they cross to the other side in the decussation of the superior cerebellar peduncles and descend to the red nuclei. Well, the sorry, one red nucleus of the contralateral side. Now here we have a neuron. This will cross again and will end up on this inferior or lower motor neuron, and this descends to the ipsilateral lower motor neuron. So at the end, what comes from the right is influenced in the right side muscles. Now the vestibulospinal tract goes mainly to the, this is called the vestibulospinal tract, and this is called the rubrospinal tract. Vestibulospinal tract, then lower motor neuron, goes primarily to extensor muscles. And rubrospinal tract, lower motor neuron, goes mainly to flexor muscles of the upper limb. Just quickly, let's review the other vestibulospinal tract. We have the influence of the vestibular system from the utricle, saccule, and semicircular canals. These are sensed by dendrites, which cell bodies are on the vestibular ganglion. The axon forms the vestibular branch of the vestibulocochlear nerve, and then enters to the brainstem through the vestibulocochlear nerve at the pontus medullary junction to the vestibular nuclei, or can go directly to the cerebral cortex, to the flocculo nodular lobe, and then to the fastigial nucleus. This can go directly to the vestibular nuclei, lateral, medial, and inferior, and axons from the medial and inferior vestibular nuclei can go to the cerebellar cortex and then the fastigial nucleus. And then from the fastigial nucleus, They go back to all the four vestibular nuclei, superior, medial, lateral, and inferior, and then the vestibulospinal tract. Now, we can have damage to the brain above the red nucleus or below the red nucleus. If it is above, it's closer to the cortex, and so it would be called a decorticate posterior. In a while we will see how it's present, and this would be a decerebrate posterior. Now, if we damage this stimulus to the flexor muscles, that is, we are damaging structures that are above the red nucleus, for example, this one, etc. So, we have now, we don't have the innervation of the upper motor neuron, lower motor neuron to the flexor muscles. But remember that between the upper and lower motor neuron, we have a interneuron that releases the inhibitory neurotransmitter. So if we don't have that this neuron is excitizing the interneuron, then the interneuron is not inhibiting the lower motor neuron, and so the muscles would be all the time contracted. So the patient would present with contraction of the flexor muscles of the upper limb. This is called the decorticate posterior or flexor posterior. On the other hand, if we damage the brain structures below the red nucleus, we are damaging the rubrospinal tract, but at damaging the rubrospinal tract, then cannot go to this lower motor neuron, and so there is no flexion of this or contraction of these flexor muscles, and there is an opposition of the vestibulospinal tract that all the time is going to the extensor muscles. Also, this one you can think it as, we are damaging things that are below the red nucleus, so also we are damaging the vestibulospinal tract, and so there is no excitation of the inhibitory or interneuron, so there is no inhibition of this lower motor neuron, and so the muscles would be in spastic paralysis, but these are extensor muscles, so the patient will present with a decerebrate or extensor posterior. So the cerebrate posterior is above the cerebrate posterior is below the red nuclei and is extensor posterior. The corticate posterior is only flexion of the upper limbs and is called the corticate posterior.